Part 2 of Mercenary by Mac Reynolds. 4. After routine morning duties, Joe Mauser returned to his billet and mystified Mac's mains by not only changing into Mufti himself, but having Max do the same. In fact, the new Batman protested faintly. He hadn't nearly, as yet, got over the glory of wearing his kilts, and was looking forward to parading around town in them. He had a point, of course. The appointed time for the fracas was getting closer, and buffs were beginning to stream into town to bask in the atmosphere of threatened death. Everybody knew what a military center on the outskirts of a fracas reservation such as the Catskills was like immediately preceding a clash between rival corporations. The high-strung gaiety, the drinking, the over-tranking, the relaxation of mores. Even a rank private had it made. Admiring civilians to buy drinks and hang on your every word, and, more important still, sensuous-eyed women, their faces slack in thinly suppressed passion. It was a recognized phenomenon, even Max Maines knew, this desire on the part of women telefans to date a man and then watch him later killing or being killed. "Time enough to wear your fancy uniform," Joe Mauser growled at him. "In fact, tomorrow's a local election day. Parlay that up on top of all the fracas fans gravitating into town, and you'll have a wingding the likes of nothing you've seen before."
"Well, yes, sir," Max begrudged. "Where are we going now, Captain?"
"To the airport. Come along." Joe Mauser led the way to his sports hover car, and as soon as the two were settled into the bucket seats, hit the lift lever with the butt of his left hand. Air cushion borne, he trod down on the accelerator. Max Main was impressed.
"You know," he said, "I never been in one of these swanky sports jobs before. The kind of car you can afford on the income of a mid-lower stock aunt."
"Knock it off," Joe said wearily. "Carping we'll always have with us, evidently. But in spite of all the beefing in every strata from low-lower to upper-middle, I've yet to see any signs of organized protest against our present politico-economic system."
"Hey," Max said, "don't get me wrong. What was good enough for Dad is good enough for me. You won't catch me talking against the government."
"Hmm," Joe murmured. "And all the other clichés taught to us to preserve the status quo, our people's capitalism." They were reaching the outskirts of town, crossing the Esopus. The airport lay only a mile or so beyond. It was obviously too deep for Max, and since he didn't understand, he assumed his superior didn't know what he was talking about. He said tolerantly,
"Well, what's wrong with people's capitalism? Everybody owns the corporations. Damn sight better than the Soves have."
Joe said sourly, "We've got one optical illusion, they've got another, Max. Over there, they claim the proletariat owns the means of production. Great. But the party members are the ones who control it, and, as a result, they manage to do all right for themselves. The party hierarchy over there are like our uppers over here."
"Yeah."
Max was being particularly dense.
"I've seen a lot about it on telly. You know, when there isn't a good fracas on, you tune to one of them educational shows, like—"
Joe winced at the term educational, but held his peace.
"It's pretty rugged over there. But in the West world, the people own a corporation stock, and they run it and get the benefit."
"At least it makes a beautiful story," Joe said dryly. "Look, Max, suppose you have a corporation that has 200,000 shares out, and they're distributed among 100,001 persons. 100,000 of those own one share apiece, but the remaining stockholder owns the other 100,000.
"I don't know what you're getting at," Max said.
Joe Mauser was tired of the discussion. "Briefly," he said, "we have the illusion that this is a people's capitalism, with all stocks in the hands of the people. Actually, as ever before, the stock is in the hands of the uppers, all except a mere dribble. They own the country, and they run it for their own benefit." Max shot a less than military glance at him.
"Hey, you're not one of those Soviets yourself, are you?"
They were coming into the parking area near the administration building of the airport. "No," Joe said so softly that Max could hardly hear his words. "Only a mid-middle on the make." Followed by Max, he strode quickly to the administration building, presented his credit identification at the desk, and requested a light aircraft for a period of 3 hours. The clerk, hardly looking up, began going through the motions, speaking into telescreens. The clerk said finally,
"You might have a small wait, sir. Quite a few of the officers involved in this fracas have been renting out taxi planes almost as fast as they're available."
That didn't surprise Joe Mauser. Any competent officer made a point of an aerial survey of the battle reservation before going into a fracas. Aircraft, of course, couldn't be used during the fray, since they post-dated the turn of the century, and hence were relegated to the cemetery of military devices, along with such items as nuclear weapons, tanks, and even gasoline-propelled vehicles of size to be useful. Use an aircraft in a fracas, or even build an aircraft for military usage, and you'd have a howl go up from the military attachés from the Sov world that would be heard all the way to Budapest. Not a fracas went by, but there were scores, if not hundreds, of military observers, keen-eyed to check whether or not any really modern tools of war were being illegally utilized. Joe Mauser sometimes wondered if the West world observers, over in the Sov world, were as hair-fine in their living up to the rules of the Universal Disarmament Pact. Probably, but for that matter, they didn't have the same system of fighting fracases over there as in the West. Joe took a chair while he waited and thumbed through a fan magazine. From time to time he found his own face in such publications. He was a third-rate celebrity, really. Luck hadn't been with him so far as the buffs were concerned. They wanted spectacular victories, murderous situations in which they could lose themselves in vicarious sadistic thrills. Joe had reached most of his peaks while in retreat or commanding a holding action. His officers appreciated him, and so did the ultra-knowledgeable fracas buffs, but he was all but an unknown to the average dimwit who spent most of his life glued to the telly set, watching men butcher each other. On the various occasions when matters had pickled and Joe had to fight his way out against difficult odds, using spectacular tactics in desperation, he was almost always off camera. Purely luck. On top of skill, determination, experience, and courage, you had to have luck in the military category to get anywhere. This time, Joe was going to manufacture his own. A voice said, "Ah, Captain Mauser." Joe looked up, then came to his feet quickly. In automatic reflex, he began to come to the salute, but then caught himself. He said stiffly, "My compliments, Marshal Cogswell." The other was a smallish man, but strikingly strong of face and strongly built. His voice was clipped, clear, and had the air of command, as though born with it. He, like Joe, wore mufti, and now extended his hand to be shaken. "I hear you've signed up with Baron Hare, Captain. I was rather expecting you to come in with me. Had a place for a good aide-de-camp. Liked your work in that last fracas we went through together." "Thank you, sir," Joe said. Stonewall Cogswell was as good a tactician as freelanced, and he was more than that. He was a judge of men and a stickler for detail. And right now, if Joe Mauser knew Marshal Stonewall Cogswell as well as he thought, Cogswell was smelling a rat. There was no reason why old pro Joe Mauser should sign up with a sure loser like Vacuum Tube when he could have earned more shares taking a commission with Hovercraft. He was looking at Joe brightly, the question in his eyes. Three or four of his staff were behind a few paces, looking polite. But Cogswell didn't bring them into the conversation. Joe knew most by sight. Good men all. Old pros all. He felt another twinge of doubt. Joe had to cover. He said, "I was offered a particularly good contract, sir. Too good to resist." The other nodded, as though inwardly coming to a satisfactory conclusion. "Baron Hare's connections, eh? He's probably offered to back you for a bounce in cast. Is that it, Joe?" Joe Mauser flushed. Stonewall Cogswell knew what he was talking about. He'd been born into middle status himself, and had become an upper the hard way. His path wasn't as long as Joe's was going to be, but long enough, and he knew how rocky the climb was. How very rocky. Joe said stiffly, "I'm afraid I'm in no position to discuss my commander's military contracts, Marshal. We're in Mufti, but, after all—" Cogswell's lean face registered one of his infrequent grimaces of humor. "I understand, Joe. Well, good luck, and I hope things don't pickle for you in the coming fracas. Possibly we'll find ourselves aligned together again at some future time." "Thank you, sir," Joe said, once more having to catch himself to prevent an automatic salute. Cogswell and his staff went off, leaving Joe looking after them. Even the Marshal's staff members were top men, any of whom could have conducted a divisional magnitude fracas. Joe felt the coldness in his stomach again. Although it must have looked like a cinch, the enemy wasn't taking any chances whatsoever. Cogswell and his officers were undoubtedly here at the airport for the same reason as Joe. They wanted a thorough aerial reconnaissance of the battlefield to be before the issue was joined. Max was standing at his elbow.
"Who was that, sir? Looks like a real tough one."
"He is a real tough one," Joe said sourly. "That's Stonewall Cogswell, the best field commander in North America." Max pursed his lips.
"I never seen him out of uniform before. Lots of times on telly, but never out of uniform. I thought he was taller than that."
"He fights with his brains," Joe said, still looking after the craggy field marshal. "He doesn't have to be any taller." Max scowled.
"Where do you ever get that nickname, sir?"
"Stonewall?" Joe was turning to resume his chair and magazine. "He's supposed to be a student of a top general back in the American Civil War. Uses some of the original Stonewall's tactics." Max was out of his depth.
"American Civil War? Was that much of a fracas, Captain? It must have been before my time."
"It was quite a fracas," Joe said dryly. "Lot of good lads dead. 100 years after it was fought, the reasons it was fought seemed about as valid as those we fight fracases for today. Personally, I—" He had to cut it short. They were calling him on the address system. His aircraft was ready. Joe made his way to the hangars, followed by Max Maines. He was going to pilot the airplane himself, and old Stonewall Cogswell would have been surprised at what Joe Mauser was looking for. 5. By the time they had returned to quarters, there was a message waiting for Captain Mauser. He was to report to the officer commanding reconnaissance. Joe redressed in the hare kilts and proceeded to headquarters. The officer commanding reconnaissance turned out to be none other than Bald Hare, natty as ever, and as ever, arrogantly tapping his swagger stick against his leg.
"Zen, Captain," he complained, "where have you been?
off on a trank kick. We've got to get organized.
Joe Mauser snapped him a salute.
No, sir. I rented an aircraft to scout out the terrain over which we'll be fighting.
Indeed. And what were your impressions, Captain?
There was an overtone which suggested that it made little difference what impressions a captain of cavalry might have gained.
Joe shrugged.
Largely mountains, hills, woods. Good reconnaissance is going to make the difference in this one. And in the fracas itself, cavalry is going to be more important than either artillery or infantry. A Nathan Forrest fracas, sir. A matter of getting there fustest with the mostest.
Bald Hare said amusedly, "Thanks for your opinion, Captain. Fortunately, our staff has already come largely to the same conclusions. Undoubtedly, they'll be glad to hear your wide experience bears them out."
Joe said evenly, "It's a rather obvious conclusion, of course." He took this as it came, having been through it before. The dilettante amateur's dislike of the old pro. The amateur in command who knew full well he was less capable than many of those below him in rank.
"Of course, Captain."
Bald Hare flicked his swagger stick against his leg. "But to the point. Your squadron is to be deployed as scouts under my overall command. You've had cavalry experience, I assume?"
"Yes, sir, in various fracases over the past 15 years."
"Very well. Now then, to get to the reason I have summoned you. Yesterday, in my father's office, you intimated that you had some grandiose scheme which would bring victory to the Hare colors, but then, on some thin excuse, refused to divulge just what the scheme might be."
Joe Mauser looked at him unblinkingly. Bald Hare said, "Now I'd like to have your opinion on just how vacuum tube transport can extract itself from what would seem a poor position at best." In all, there were four others in the office, two women clerks fluttering away at typers, and two of Bald Hare's junior officers. They seemed only mildly interested in the conversation between Bald and Joe. Joe wet his lips carefully. The Hare scion was his commanding officer. He said, "Sir, what I had in mind is a new gimmick. At this stage, if I told anybody and it leaked, it'd never be effective, not even this first time."
Hare observed him coldly.
"And you think me incapable of keeping your secret, gimmick, I believe is the idiomatic term you used?"
Joe Mauser's eyes shifted around the room, taking in the other four, who were now looking at him.
Bald Hare rapped, "These members of my staff are all trusted Hare employees, Captain Mauser. They're not fly-by-night freelancers hired for a week or two."
Joe said,
"Yes, sir. But it's been my experience that one person can hold a secret. It's twice as hard for two, and from there on it's a decreasing probability in geometric ratio."
The younger Hare's stick rapped the side of his leg impatiently.
"Suppose I inform you that this is a command, Captain. I have little confidence in a supposed gimmick that will rescue our forces from disaster, and I rather dislike the idea of a captain of one of my squadrons dashing about with such a bee in his bonnet when he should be obeying my commands."
Joe kept his voice respectful.
"Then, sir, I'd request that we take the matter to the Commander-in-Chief, your father."
"Indeed,"
Joe said. "Sir, I've been working on this a long time. I can't afford to risk throwing the idea away."
Bald Hare glared at him.
"Very well, Captain. I'll call your bluff. Come along."
He turned on his heel and headed from the room. Joe Mauser shrugged in resignation and followed him. The old Baron wasn't much happier about Joe Mauser's secrets than was his son. It had only been the day before that he had taken Joe on,
but already he had seemed to have aged in appearance. Evidently, each hour that went by made it increasingly clear just how perilous a position he had assumed. Vacuum tube transport had elbowed, buffaloed, bluffed, and edged itself up to the outskirts of the really big time. The Baron's ability, his aggressiveness, his flair, his political pull had all helped, but now that chips were down. He was up against one of the biggies, and this particular biggie was tired of ambitious little vacuum tube transport. He listened to his son's words, listened to Joe's defense. He said, looking at Joe,
"If I understand this, you have some scheme which you think will bring victory in spite of what seems a disastrous situation."
"Yes, sir." The two hares looked at him, one impatiently, the other in weariness. Joe said, "I'm gambling everything on this, sir. I'm no rank private in his first fracas. I deserve to be given some leeway."
Balt Hare snorted. "Gambling everything? What in Zen would you have to gamble, Captain? The whole Hare family fortunes are tied up. Hovercraft is out for blood. They won't be satisfied with a token victory and a negotiated compromise. They'll devastate us. Thousands of mercenaries killed, with all that means in indemnities. Millions upon million in expensive military equipment, most of which we've had to hire and will have to recompensate for. Can you imagine the value of our stock after Stonewall Cogswell has finished with us? Why, every 2x4 trucking outfit in North America will be challenging us, and we won't have the forces to meet a minor skirmish."
Joe reached into an inner pocket and laid a sheaf of documents on the desk of Baron Malcolm Hare. The Baron scowled down at them. Joe said simply, "I've been accumulating stock since before I was 18, and I've taken good care of my portfolio in spite of taxes and the various other pitfalls, which make the accumulation of capital practically impossible. Yesterday I sold all of my portfolio I was legally allowed to sell and converted to vacuum tube transport." He added dryly, "Getting it at an excellent rate, by the way." Balt Hare mulled through the papers, unbelievingly.
"Zen!" he ejaculated. "The fool really did it! He sunk a small fortune into our stock!"
Baron Hare growled at his son.
"You seem considerably more convinced of our defeat than the captain here. Perhaps I should reverse your positions of command."
His son grunted, but said nothing. Old Malcolm Hare's eyes came back to Joe.
"Admittedly, I thought you were on the romantic side yesterday, with your hints of some scheme which would lead us out of the wilderness, so to speak. Now I wonder if you might not really have something. Very well, I respect your claimed need for secrecy. Espionage is not exactly an antiquated military field."
"Thank you, sir." But the Baron was still staring at him.
"However, there's more to it than that. Why not take this great scheme to Marshal Cogswell? And yesterday you mentioned that the telesets of the nation would be tuned in on this fracas, and obviously you are correct. The question becomes, what of it?"
The fat was in the fire now. Joe Mauser avoided the haughty stare of young Balt Hare and addressed himself to the older man. "You have political pull, sir. Oh, I know you don't make and break presidents. You couldn't even pull enough wires to keep hovercraft from making this a divisional magnitude fracas. But you have pull enough for my needs." Baron Hare leaned back in his chair, his barrel-like body causing that article of furniture to creak. He crossed his hands over his stomach.
"And what are your needs, Captain Mauser?"
Joe said evenly, "If I can bring this off, I'll be a fracas buff celebrity. I don't have any illusions about the fickleness of the telly fans, but for a day or two I'll be on top. If at the same time I had your all-out support, pulling what strings you could reach—"
"Why, then,
you'd be promoted to upper, wouldn't you, Captain?" Balt Haer finished for him, amusement in his voice. "That's what I'm gambling on," Joe said evenly. The younger Haer grinned at his father superciliously.
"So, our captain says he will defeat Stonewall Cogswell in return for you sponsoring his becoming a member of the nation's elite."
"Good heavens! Is the supposed cream of the nation now selected on no higher a level than this?" There was sarcasm in the words. The three men turned. It was the girl Joe had bumped into the day before. The Hares didn't seem surprised at her entrance.
"Nadine," the older man growled, "Captain Joe Mauser, who has been given a commission in our forces."
Joe went through the routine of a middle of officer's rank being introduced to a lady of upper caste. She smiled at him, somewhat mockingly, and failed to make standard response. Nadine Haer said,
"I repeat, what is this service the captain can render the House of Haer so important that pressure should be brought to raise him to upper caste? It would seem unlikely that he is a noted scientist, an outstanding artist, a great teacher."
Joe said uncomfortably,
"They say the military is a science, too."
Her expression was almost as haughty as that of her brother.
"Do they? I have never thought so."
"Really, Nadine," her father grumbled, "this is hardly your affair."
"No. In a few days I shall be repairing the damage you have allowed, indeed sponsored, to be committed upon the bodies of possibly thousands of now healthy human beings."
Balt said nastily,
"Nobody asked you to join the medical staff, Nadine. You could have stayed in your laboratory, figuring out new methods of preventing the human race from replenishing itself."
The girl was obviously not the type to redden, but her anger was manifest. She spun on her brother.
"If the race continues at its present maniac course, possibly more effective methods of birth control are the most important development we could make, even to the ultimate discovery of preventing all future conception."
Joe caught himself in mid-chuckle. But not in time. She spun on him in his turn.
"Look at yourself in that silly skirt. A professional soldier. A killer. In my opinion, the most useless occupation ever devised by man. Parasite on the best and useful members of society. Destroyer by trade."
Joe began to open his mouth, but she overrode him.
"Yes, yes, I know. I've read all the nonsense that has accumulated down through the ages about the need for, the glory of, the sacrifice of the professional soldier. How they defend their country. How they give all for the common good. Zen, what nonsense."
Balt Haer was smirking sourly at her.
"The theory today is, Nadine, old thing, that professionals such as the captain are gathering experience in case a serious fracas with the Sovs ever develops. Meanwhile, his training is kept at a fine edge fighting in our inter-corporation, inter-union, or union-corporation fracases that develop in our private enterprise society."
She laughed her scorn.
"And what a theory! Limited to the weapons which prevailed before 1900. If there was ever real conflict between the Sov world and our own, does anyone really believe either would stick to such arms? Why, aircraft, armored vehicles, yes, and nuclear weapons and rockets would be in overnight use."
Joe was fascinated by her furious attack. He said,
"Then what would you say was the purpose of the fracases, miss?"
"Circuses," she snorted. "The old Roman games all over again, and 100 times worse. Blood and guts sadism. The quest of a frustrated person for satisfaction in another's pain. Our lowers of today are as useless and frustrated as the Roman proletariat, and potentially they're just as dangerous as the mob that once dominated Rome. Automation, the second industrial revolution, has eliminated for all practical purposes the need for their labor, so we give them bread and circuses.
And every year that goes by, the circuses must be increasingly sadistic, death on an increasing scale, or they aren't satisfied. Once it was enough to have fictional mayhem, cowboys and Indians, gangsters or GIs versus the Nazis, Japs or commies, but that's past. Now we need real blood and guts.
Baron Hare snapped finally.
All right, Nadine. We've heard this lecture before. I doubt if the captain is interested, particularly since you don't seem to be able to get beyond the protesting stage and have yet to come up with an answer.
I have an answer.
Ah?
Balt Hare raised his eyebrows mockingly.
Yes. Overthrow this silly status society. Resume the road to progress. Put our people to useful endeavor, instead of sitting in front of their telly sets, taking trank pills to put them in a happy daze, and watching sadistic fracases to keep them in thrills, and their minds from their condition.
Joe had figured on keeping out of the controversy with this firebrand, but now, really interested, he said,
"Progress to where?"
She must have caught in his tone that he wasn't needling. She frowned at him.
"I don't know man's goal, if there is one. I'm not even sure it's important. It's the road that counts, the endeavor, the dream, the effort expended to make a world a better place than it was at the time of your birth."
Balt Hare said mockingly, "That's the trouble with you, sis. Here we've reached Utopia, and you don't admit it."
"Utopia?"
"Certainly. Take a poll. You'll find 19 people out of 20 happy with things just the way they are. They have full tummies and security, lots of leisure and trank pills to make matters seem even rosier than they are, and they're rather rosy already."
"Then what's the necessity of this endless succession of bloody fracases, covered to the most minute bloody detail on the telly?"
Baron Hare cut things short.
"We've hashed and rehashed this before, Nadine, and now we're too busy to debate further."
He turned to Joe Mauser.
"Very well, Captain. You have my pledge. I wish I felt as optimistic as you seem to be about your prospects. That will be all for now, Captain."
Joe saluted and executed an about-face. In the outer offices, when he had closed the door behind him, he rolled his eyes upward in mute thanks to whatever powers might be. He had somehow gained the enmity of Balt, his immediate superior, but he'd also gained the support of Baron Hare himself, which counted considerably more. He considered for a moment Nadine Hare's words. She was obviously a malcontent, but, on the other hand, her opinions of his chosen profession weren't too different than his own. However, given this victory, this upgrading in caste, and Joe Mauser would be in a position to retire. The door opened and shut behind him, and he half turned. Nadine Hare, evidently still caught up in the hot words between herself and her relatives, glared at him, all of which stressed the beauty he had noticed the day before. She was an almost unbelievably pretty girl, particularly when flushed with anger. It occurred to him with a blow-like suddenness that if his caste was raised to upper, he would be in a position to woo such as Nadine Hare. He looked into her furious face and said, "I was intrigued, Miss Hare, with what you had to say, and I'd like to discuss some of your points. I wonder if I could have the pleasure of your company at some nearby refreshment—"
"My, how formal an invitation, Captain! I suppose you had in mind sitting and flipping back a few trank pills."
Joe looked at her.
"I don't believe I've had a trank in the past 20 years, Miss Hare. Even as a boy, I didn't particularly take to having my senses dulled with drug-induced pleasure."
Some of her fury was abating, but she was still critical of the professional mercenary. Her eyes went up and down his uniform in scorn.
"You seem to make pretenses of being cultivated, Captain.
Then why your chosen profession?
He'd had the answer to that for long years. He said now simply, I told you I was born a lower. Given that, little counts until I fight my way out of it. Had I been born in a feudalist society, I would have attempted to batter myself into the nobility. Under classical capitalism, I would have done my utmost to accumulate a fortune, enough to reach an effective position in society. Now, under people's capitalism, she snorted, industrial feudalism would be the better term. I realize I can't even start to fulfill myself until I am a member of the upper caste. Her eyes had narrowed, and the anger was largely gone.
But you chose the military field in which to better yourself?
Government propaganda to the contrary, it is practically impossible to raise yourself in other fields. I didn't build this world. Possibly I don't even approve of it. But since I'm in it, I have no recourse but to follow its rules. Her eyebrows arched.
Why not try to change the rules?
Joe blinked at her.
Nadine Hare said, Let's look up that refreshment you were talking about. In fact, there's a small coffee bar around the corner where it'd be possible for one of Baron Hare's brood to have a cup with one of her father's officers of middle caste.
6. The following morning, hands on the pillow beneath his head, Joe Mauser stared up at the ceiling of his room and rehashed his session with Nadine Hare. It hadn't taken him 5 minutes to come to the conclusion that he was in love with the girl, but it had taken him the rest of the evening to keep himself under rein and not let the fact get through to her. He wanted to talk about the way her mouth tucked in at the corners, but she was hot on the evolution of society. He would have liked to have kissed that impossibly perfectly shaped ear of hers, but she was all for exploring the reasons why man had reached his present impasse. Joe was for holding hands and staring into each other's eyes. She was for delving into the differences between the West world and the Sov world, and the possibility of resolving them. Of course, to keep her company at all, it had been necessary to suppress his own desires and to go along. It obviously had never occurred to her that a middle might have romantic ideas involving Nadine Hare. It had simply not occurred to her, no matter the radical teaching she advocated. Most of their world was predictable from what had gone before. In spite of popular fable to the contrary, the division between classes had become increasingly clear. Among other things, tax systems were such that it became all but impossible for a citizen born poor to accumulate a fortune. Through ability, he might rise to the point of earning fabulous sums, and wind up in debt to the tax collector. A great inventor, a great artist, had little chance of breaking into the domain of what finally became the small percentage of the population now known as uppers. Then, too, the rising cost of a really good education became such that few other than those born into the middle or upper castes could afford the best of schools. Castes tended to perpetuate themselves. Politically, the nation had fallen increasingly deeper into the two-party system, both parties of which were tightly controlled by the same group of uppers. Elections had become a farce, a great national holiday in which stereotyped patriotic speeches, pretenses of unity between all castes, picnics, beer busts, and trank binges predominated for one day. Economically, too, the augurs had been there. Production of the basics had become so profuse that poverty in the old sense of the word had become nonsensical. There was an abundance of the necessities of life for all. Social security, socialized medicine, unending unemployment insurance, old age pensions, pensions for veterans, for widows and children, for the unfit, pensions and doles for this, that, and the other, had doubled and doubled again, until everyone had security for life.
The uppers, true enough, had opulence far beyond that known by the middles, and lived like gods compared to the lowers. But all had security. They had agreed thus far, Joe and Nadine. But then had come debate. "Then why," Joe had asked her, "haven't we achieved what your brother called it? Why isn't this utopia? Isn't it what man has been yearning for down through the ages? Where did the wheel come off? What happened to the dream?" Nadine had frowned at him, beautifully, he thought. "It's not the first time man has found abundance in a society, though never to this degree. The Incas had it, for instance." "I don't know much about them," Joe admitted. "An early form of communism, with a sort of military priesthood at the top." She had nodded, her face serious as always. "And for themselves, the Romans more or less had it, at the expense of the nations they conquered, of course." "And," Joe prodded, "and in these examples the same thing developed. Society ossified. Joe," she said, using his first name for the first time, and in a manner that set off a new countdown in his blood, "a ruling caste and a socio-economic system perpetuates itself just so long as it ever can. No matter what damage it may do to society as a whole, it perpetuates itself even to the point of complete destruction of everything. Remember Hitler, Adolf the Aryan, and his thousand-year Reich? When it became obvious he had failed, and the only thing that could result from continued resistance would be destruction of Germany's cities and millions of her people, did he and his clique resign or surrender? Certainly not. They attempted to bring down the whole German structure in a Götterdämmerung." Nadine Hare was deep into her theme, her eyes flashing her conviction. "A socio-economic system reacts like a living organism. It attempts to live on, indefinitely, agonizingly, no matter how antiquated it might have become. The Roman politico-economic system continued for centuries after it should have been replaced. Such reformers as the Gracchus brothers were assassinated or thrust aside so that the entrenched elements could perpetuate themselves. And when Rome finally fell, darkness descended for a thousand years on Western progress." Joe had never gone this far in his thoughts. He said now, somewhat uncomfortably, "Well, what would replace what we have now? If you took power from you uppers, who could direct the country? The lowers? That's not even funny. Take away their fracases and their trank pills, and they'd go berserk. They don't want anything else." Her mouth worked. "Admittedly, we've already allowed things to deteriorate much too far. We should have done something long ago. I'm not sure I know the answer. All I know is that, in order to maintain the status quo, we're not utilizing the efforts of more than a fraction of our people. 9 out of 10 of us spend our lives sitting before the telly, sucking tranks. Meanwhile, the motivation for continued progress seems to have withered away. Our upper political circles are afraid some seemingly minor change might avalanche, so more and more we lean upon the old ways of doing things." Joe had put up a mild argument. "I've heard the case made that the lowers are fools, and the reason our present socio-economic system makes it so difficult to rise from lower to upper is that you cannot make a fool understand he is one. You can only make him angry. If some, who are not fools, are allowed to advance from lower to upper, the vast mass who are fools will be angry, because they are not allowed to. That's why the military category is made a channel of advance. To take that road, a man gives up his security, and he'll die if he's a fool." Nadine had become scornful. "That reminds me of the old contention by racial segregationalists that the Negroes smelled bad. First, they put them in a position where they had insufficient bathing facilities, their diet inadequate, and their teeth uncared for, and then protested that they couldn't be associated with because of their odor. Today, we are born within our castes. If an upper is inadequate, he nevertheless remains an upper. An accident of birth makes him an aristocrat. Environment, family, training, education, friends, traditions, and laws maintain him in that position. But a lower, who potentially has the greatest of value to society, is born handicapped, and he's hard put not to wind up before a telly in a mental daze from trank. Sure, he's a fool. He's never been allowed to develop himself. Yes, Joe reflected now, it had been quite an evening. In a life of more than 30 years devoted to rebellion, he had never met anyone so outspoken as Nadine Hare, nor one who had thought it through as far as she had. He grunted. His own revolt was against the level at which he had found himself in society, not the structure of society itself. His whole raison d'etre was to lift himself to upper status. It came as a shock to him to find a person he admired, who had been born into upper caste, desirous of tearing the whole system down. His thoughts were interrupted by the door opening and the face of Max Maines grinning in at him. Joe was mildly surprised at his orderly not knocking before opening the door. Max evidently had a lot to learn. The little man blurted,
"Come on, Joe, let's go out on the town."
"Joe?" Joe Mauser raised himself to one elbow and stared at the other. "Leaving aside the merits of your suggestion for the moment, do you think you should address an officer by his first name?" Max Maines came fully into the bedroom, his grin still wider.
"You forgot. It's election day."
"Oh." Joe Mauser relaxed into his pillow. "So it is. No duty for today, eh?"
"No duty for anybody," Max crowed. "What do you say we go into town and have a few drinks in one of the upper bars?"
Joe grunted, but began to arise. "What'll that accomplish? On election day, most of the uppers get done up in their oldest clothes and go slumming down in the lower quarters." Max wasn't to be put off so easily.
"Well, wherever we go, let's get going. Zen, I'll bet this town is full of fracas buffs from as far as Philly. And on election day to boot. Wouldn't it be something if I found me a real fracas fan, some upper dame?"
Joe laughed at him, even as he headed for the bathroom. As a matter of fact, he rather liked the idea of going into town for the show.
"Max," he said over his shoulder, "you're in for a big disappointment. They're all the same, upper, lower, or middle."
"Yeah?" Max grinned back at him. "Well, I like the pleasure of finding out if that's true by personal experience."
End of part 2.